songbook to page 360 and stand with us. Jesus saves. Yes, amen. 360.
The aisle, everybody. Shake hands with somebody tonight. Greet your neighbor in the house of the Lord. Welcome tonight to the house of the Lord. We appreciate all of you being here, and so thankful that Brother Dan joined our church this morning. Glad he's back tonight, which I knew he would be. And if you're ever interested in joining, let me know. We'll have a short meeting, and basically we get people's salvation experience, and then we go from there, okay? But again, welcome tonight. We'll be here Wednesday night at 7 p.m., all right? Remember, Wednesday night service at 7 p.m. Now, we were told in the prayer room that Brother Dallas Kirby's dad's going to have about a six-hour surgery probably this coming Thursday or Friday. So we want you to pray for Brother Dallas Kirby's dad. And then Joe and Brooke are not well. Miss Krista's not completely well. And then Brother Fowler, let's see, Jimmy Fowler's not back tonight. Had an episode at the end of the service this morning, but they're doing okay, but not here. And then Miss Barbara Pearson, pray for Miss Barbara Pearson. Glad you're here, Miss Pearson, your husband told us to pray for you and the things you're experiencing. And then, of course, Miss Peggy Mullinax, all right? Those are some of the new ones. There's a youth choir. The can's pulling double duty. You worship with the youth choir, all right?
They told me that Jesus would carry my burdens. They told me that he surely would pilot me through. They told me to cast my cares completely upon him. And I found all they said about my Jesus is true.
Eternally,
was passing his way. He heard everybody who met him forever was changed. And a touch from the Master's great hand, I believe he proclaimed.
Kind of reminds me of the song, of the chapter in the Bible where the Queen of Sheba came over to see Solomon's grandeur and the temple and all that he had accomplished. And she said, "The half has never been told." And I'll tell you this about the Christian life, about Jesus himself, and listen, about heaven, the half has never been told. Never has. We need to stay excited about it. I mean that sincerely. We need to stay excited about the things that we most assuredly believe, all right? Thank you, choirs, both of you. Thank you, Brother Cam. I want everybody to keep in mind, again, November 21st, that's a Tuesday night before Thanksgiving on a Thursday. And so we're having a big time of fellowship, special big breakfast. We'll not have Wednesday night service. This will be like a substitute Wednesday night service, but that'll be November the 21st. We don't want you to miss it. Our deacons and several more will be coordinating all that, and they're already working, planning. And again, I appreciate the diligence and those great things. So thank you so much, men. But don't miss that night. And then I had a brother come to me this morning. I'm glad he did. And we want you to turn in your information for the directory, all right? If your numbers, if you want your mobiles listed, your home address, all your information, it needs to be turned in. Please do that. so we can get that project complete. That will be greatly appreciated. Then this Thursday, yes, that's right, this Thursday, the Miracle Hill Ministries, and I'm sure we're going regardless of Brother Ivester, if he's not well. I know they're all not well, but regardless if he's not well, we're still going. Josh or somebody will be speaking or something like that. But that's this Thursday, and we'll leave. We'll meet. We'll meet there at 6:40. All right, 6:40 p.m. on Thursday night. All right. Let's have the ushers come on in. Well, they're in. We're going to come right now, and then I believe this is probably our first home game. That's the 14th, which is about 2 days from now. No, that can't be. That's Tuesday night. Yes, yes. November 14th, first home basketball game. All right. So if you'd like to come to the home basketball game, it's November 14th, and all that will be starting at about 4:30, okay? 4:30 that afternoon if you'd like to enjoy the things on that particular day, all right? God bless you now. Again, we say this sincerely. Everybody needs to be tithers and givers, amen? Everybody needs to be tithers and givers. God bless you as you please. Josiah, Brother Josiah. How many of you know the song she was playing? You know that, right? Tell me the story of Jesus. Right on my heart, every word. And I don't say enough about this, but you cannot compare that to contemporary Christian music. There's just no, they're not in the same ballpark. They're not. And I want to say to this church that you can never improve on those old-time hymns. For the truth of them. That's taught in those songs. Great, great song that you were playing. Thank you, Tiffany. All right, next Sunday, the Lord willing, that will be the 19th. And I've asked him. He never asks. He doesn't mention this kind of stuff. But I asked him to bring several copies of the book that he's written about biblical civics. Isn't that the title, Biblical Civics? Government Christianity, and I already have a copy, and he'll have several copies available. And you'd be well served to get one of this brother's copies. It's just really, really good. It's enlightening. It's informative. It will help you to understand a whole lot of things. So, Brother Josiah, I'm proud of you, and we support what you're doing. And I want him to come pray over the offering. But listen. Get one of the books next week, all right? You'll have them here. I think they're, did you tell me they're 11? $9. Not $9, that's great. $9, so bring the money, see him. We might even set up a book table, something to help him promote these. He's one of our own people, and we want to support him, all right? Brother Josiah, pray for us. If you want to say a word, say a word.
Well, I will thank you. First of all, thank you, preacher, for letting me provide that to the church, and I'm very honored to, you know, be able to do that. And it's been a lot of work. It's almost 3 years worth of studying, trying to figure out what does Scripture have to say about, you know, government, why God created government, and what Christians should do to be involved in that. I want to make sure that I'm doing my job as an elected official, and I want to try to equip you, you know, to be a light. And there's a lot of people out there that are, you know, saying, well, we just need to, you know, hunker down, you know, sort of hide our light under a bushel. And I want to, you know, encourage you that that's not the case. You know, we need to be occupied until Jesus comes. And I think there's a lot that Christians can do to make a difference, to be salt and light. And so there's some things in the book that I think will challenge and encourage you. So, again, thank you, preacher, for that opportunity.
And just before you pray, if you wasn't here Wednesday night, we just had Brother Walford's daughter-in-law got elected for the Cowpens Town Council, and then Brother Jared is now the Cowpens mayor. Isn't that great? So the point is, we don't have to put our light under a bushel. Mm-hmm. We can get involved, amen?
Yes.
We can get involved. So that's good stuff, all right? God bless you.
Thank you, preacher. Let's pray together. Dear Father, we just praise you this evening for the opportunity to once again to be in church and to once again give, Lord, to your ministry, to your work, Lord. And we just praise you that you continue to bring souls to yourself. You continue to draw with the Holy Spirit and, Lord, with the lifting up of Christ, Lord, to the world. You are drawing all men to him. And, Lord, we just pray that you'll continue to use us as that light and to continue to bring the gospel to others. And, Lord, we pray that you would use these gifts that we're giving tonight, Lord, for that purpose. Lord, we just pray that your blessing will be on the church here. Thank you for my pastor. Thank you, Lord, for so many here in the church that are an encouragement to me and strengthen me in my Christian walk. I pray you'll be with us tonight, Lord, as we continue to honor you. Lord, may we worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. And may you be with, Lord, the gift and the giver. And thank you so much for this opportunity we have, Lord, to invest in your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, ushers. Our first trio. All right. You worship with them. All right. Hey, all right. Sing it now. Sing it.
If you see me crying and know of my pain, don't say trusting God is in vain. He draws nearer to troubled souls. Trials are worth more than gold. Through fire and water, if that's where he leads, I am willing to go. If more like Jesus I'll be, trials are worth more than gold. Moses and Daniel and prophets of old, they were tried by Satan, I'm told. We must walk the very same road. Trials are worth more than gold. Through fire and water, if that's where he leads, I am willing to go. If more like Jesus I'll be, trials are worth more than gold. If more like Jesus I'll be, trials are worth more than gold.
Amen. Very good. How true. How true. All right, Miss Desiree, come on. She'll sing one, and then we'll preach in just a moment, all right? God bless you. You worship with her while she's singing. All right, Tiffy's going to play.
Thought, oh, words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God.
Great. Thank you very much. That's another one of the old songs. Amen. Never going to improve on them. Take your Bible, everybody. And I know somebody wanted me to go to Romans 8 tonight, but I just don't think I could give it justice right now. Was there the 1st of October. We'll be back to Romans 8. But right now, I want you to turn to John chapter number 12, everybody. John chapter number 12 in your Bible. Hope you have a copy of the Word of God with you this evening, okay? Share with somebody that doesn't have a copy, all right? Stay with me tonight. We'll not be very long. Hope everybody has a great week. Hope people soon will be feeling better. We have several that are not well, several not here tonight, and because of not feeling well. And just pray that God will touch their body, get them better soon, all right? Now, if you remember Wednesday night, I preached about Martha and Martha's service. And I think my title, Brother Galloway, was Martha's Service with a Smile. Amen. Service with a Smile. I want to pick up with Martha again. And I want us to look in God's Word. And Brother Derek, Brother Caden, I want us to get another glimpse of another episode or an experience in Martha's life. And I hope the Lord will help me to highlight what needs to be highlighted. John, now you know we find Martha in Luke 10, you know that. And then, I didn't do it tonight, but we also find Martha in John 11 when the Lord raised Lazarus from the dead and Mary and Martha both had came to the Lord, Brother Bob, and had great serious conversation with him. So we could go back, Lee, to John 11, but I'm going to put that aside. And we're going to concentrate tonight on John 12. Look at verse 1. Then 6 days before the Passover. Well, let me get it right. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead. Whom he raised from the dead. By the way, that's what happened to you and I. Made us alive. Now watch this now. There, in Bethany, they made him a supper. Watch this. And Martha served. She's doing the same thing that she was doing the last time we looked at her life. Can I say something right here? Thank God for faithfulness. Confidence in an unfaithful man is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. And Brother Todd, both of those hurt. So thank God. That's my first remark, Brother Clifford. Thank God. Pray for his wife, by the way. She's doing better, getting pins out in the next couple days. But Martha was faithful at doing the task that she was always doing. Amen. The Bible said in verse 2, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Now watch this. So true to form here. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that is an exquisite act of worship. Amen. Verse number 4. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief. You got that under control? And what was that? You don't know either. I don't know either. That's all right. Verse 6, and he had the bag and bare what was put therein. Verse 7, then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burying has she kept this. For the poor always you have with you, but me you have not always. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. Verse 10, but the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. The testimony of Lazarus being raised from the dead brought salvation to many of those people that saw that notable and great miracle. And by the way, physically what that stands for has happened to you and I spiritually. Amen. I want to talk to you again tonight about Martha. I want us to pray first. Josh, if you would you stand right there? I want you to really pray God will help us tonight. Amen. Thank you very much. I would encourage the congregation before me this evening to please keep your Bibles open and to follow with me if you can, if you will, in the particular scriptures that we're going to be dealing with. And I want to start tonight by going backwards to John chapter number 11. Please go there. I'd like to show, lift one verse out of here. John chapter 11, please, everybody. Look, if you will, in verse number 5. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Could I say to you tonight that his love doesn't change for either one of them? His love, Brother Randy, is the same for all three of them. He doesn't love Mary more than he loves Martha, although Mary's the worshiper and Martha is the worker. The Bible said he loves Martha, he loved Mary, and he loved Lazarus. He didn't love Lazarus any more than he loved Mary, but although he raised Lazarus from the dead, he didn't love Lazarus any more than he loved Martha, although, again, there was a difference in their main features of their life. Could I tell you this tonight? The Lord is no respect of person. He's no respect of persons. And I want to reiterate and say to our audience this evening that his love for me and his love for you, it's not on the basis of our earning it or our deserving it or are meriting it. You know, some people would think, well, if I do this, he'll love me more. If I'll get involved in this, he'll love me more. Could I tell you tonight, according to that verse right there, he loves you just like you are. And listen to this, he loves us equally. He loves us equally. The Lord doesn't have favorites. The Lord doesn't show partiality. The Lord's love is the same for me as it is for Samuel McGinnis. And I'm glad it doesn't matter where you are and what you're doing and how involved you are or how not involved you might be. Hey, you'll never change the love of God. And you'll never change the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think I need to say another word right here. If you've never been saved, if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have no idea how much he loves you. I mean, brother, he loves you enough how to go to an old rugged cross and shed his blood and die as your substitute. I'm telling you, you don't have to go to hell. You don't have to die in your sin. You don't have to live one more day without the Savior. If you could only realize how much God really loves you, how much Christ really loves you, how much the Holy Spirit really loves you. And I want to add this tonight. We love you as well. And we don't want you to go to hell. We don't want you to remain another day unsaved by the grace of God. And so if you're here tonight, if you're here tonight and you've never given your life to Christ, I want you to know that even though you have not given your life to Christ, he still loves you. So why are you preaching that? Well, if you got any sense, you know why I'm preaching that. If you was in the prayer room, you know why I'm preaching that. He loves us, amen. He loves every sinner, no matter what the sin, no matter how far down you are, no matter where you came from, no matter what you've done, no matter how bad you are, no matter how low you are, no matter how much sin you have, no matter what you've ever done in your life, I want you to know that God loves your soul. And Jesus, thank God, Jesus paid the price. Jesus paid the price. You don't have to go to hell. You do not have to go to hell. He paid for you. Did you hear me? He paid for you. He redeemed all of us. Redemption has to be appropriated to your life personally for it to become yours. But he redeems you. When he died on that cross, oh Lord, he had you in mind. That's right, young lady, he had you in mind. Young man, he had you in mind. You know what the Bible said, Brother John? For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. What was the joy set before it? Oh, friend, do you really want to know? Do you really want to know? You know what the joy that was set before him was? It was you. It was you. That one day you'd get saved. One day you trust him. One day you surrender your life. And one day you give your life to Christ. And let me say this tonight. Now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. There's no sense in delaying the salvation of your soul tonight. When somebody loves you that much, why don't you just give in? Why don't you just surrender? Why don't you just say yes and let God save your soul? Amen. When I got saved, Josh, I didn't know hardly anything. I don't know a whole lot now. But when I got saved, you know what? Miss Deal, I found out that night that somebody loved me more than my mama could ever love me. Brother Randy, I found out more. Somebody loved me more than my daddy could ever love me. Miss Bonnie, more than my brother and my sister could ever love me. And listen, I'm going to give you the verse, all right? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth in him, that's you, should not perish but have everlasting life. You want me to go on? I will. Greater life hath no man than this, that a man would lay down his life
for his friend. You want me to go on? But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Yea, I have drawn thee with an everlasting love. There never has been a time where God didn't love you. There never will be a time when God doesn't love you. He loved you from eternity past. He'll love you for all of eternity. He loves you now. He loves you tonight. He loves you next year. He loves you 5 years from now. Why in the world would anybody turn down that kind of love? Let God save you tonight. Let the Lord into your life. Let the Lord into your life. Open the door, amen. Open the door and let Jesus come into your life. Amen. Y'all okay, everybody? You say, well, I don't know much about it. I just don't know much about it. Well, watch me, okay? Say, I don't understand it all. Well, watch me. Watch me, okay? Here it is. This is what happened to me. This is what happened to Brother Spencer. This is what happened to Brother Walford. What happened to Brother Jack. This is what happened to Brother Joe. When I was 16 years old, Joe. See, that's what happened. Not all of it, Brother Gordon, but in my heart. In my heart, Caden, Heidi, he began to knock. Dallas, he just began to knock. And oh, hey, man, I feel like running. You know what he was saying? Why don't you let me in? Why don't you let me in? Please let me in. I'm standing outside the door of your heart. I want to come into your life. I want to give you eternal life. I want to save your soul from hell. I want to give you the greatest thing you could ever have. I want to give you the free gift of eternal salvation. He was knocking at my heart. He was knocking at my heart. You know what I did? I'll tell you what I did, Brother Bob Jackson, and I'm so glad I did. Look up here, everybody. Look this way if you can see me in the corner. Brother John, you know what I did? I opened the door. Open the door. I said, come in. Come in. Come without money. Come without price. Come just as you are. What are you going to do, Fanny Crosby? What are you going to do, Fanny Crosby? Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. O Lamb of God, I come. And that's how you say, is it that easy? Hey, young lady, young man, mom, dad, boy, girl, open the door of your heart and let Jesus come in. Open the door of your life and let Jesus Christ come into your life and save you. Listen to me, and you will never be the same. You'll never be the same. Aren't you glad? I'm not trying to get an amen out of you. I'm not trying, but it'll be help you right here. Aren't you glad you opened the door? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I didn't earn it. I surely didn't deserve it. I couldn't do anything to merit it. I just opened the door. But here's the thing. I didn't open the door because there wasn't nobody there. I opened the door, Mark, because there was somebody there. So what are you talking about? He was knocking. What do you mean he was knocking? Let me use another word. He was convicting me. He was drawing me. Folks, I'm trying to put it on the lower shelf right here. I'm trying to put it on the lower shelf, Brother David, so even a little child can grab it. He was convicting me, Miss Dickie. Brother Dickie, he was convicting me. He was showing me I was a sinner. He was showing me I was lost. Lee was showing me, Mandy, that I'm going to go to hell as a lost sinner. And then thank God he was showing me, Emma Grace, that he died for me. That he shed his blood for me and that he loved me. I thought, Lord, that's right. What love. What love. I'll never forget that day. I'll never forget that day. Went down to that altar, Miss Malia, and I didn't hardly know what to do. I just didn't hardly know what to do. I was dumber than a box of rocks, all right? About anything about God and Christian. I was dumber than a box of rocks. I didn't understand none of it. I'll tell you what happened that night. I just went down to that altar. by faith. I looked up to him. I asked him to come into my life. Dallas, I invited him to come into that door. And he came into that door. And I say this not to be braggadocious, but I say this for his glory. My life has never been the same. My life has never been the same. You know what? Man, oh man. And I'm not alone in that. I'm not alone in that. His life's never been the same. 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 Hey, friend, the ground's leveled at the foot of the cross. He loves you like you are. He loves you for who you are. He loves you so much, he'll accept you just like you are. You need to get saved tonight. You need to get saved. You need to trust him tonight. You need to ask him tonight. You need to, by faith, trust him tonight. You need to make things right tonight. Hey, here's what we say. You need to get in, friend. I mean, you need to get in the big family. You'll never regret it. You'll never regret it. Can I tell you, it'd be the greatest thing that ever happened to your life? It'd be the greatest day of your life. If you'll just let, now I'll tell you this, he's not going to kick the door in. No, sir. He's not going to rear back and ram the door in. He's not going to do that. He's going to knock, and he wants you to open. Hold on, but let's get quiet just a moment. You keep on not opening it. You keep on not opening it. He very likely to leave the door of your heart and not convict you again. Or it might be years and years before he convicts you again. And I personally would not recommend that to anybody, because you're liable to die in your sins and go to hell before you ever get another chance. So I read one verse, and we've made a little bit of progress. I want to read it again. John 11:5. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister, that's Mary, and Brother David, and Lazarus. Go back to John 12. Look at verse number 2. There they made him a supper, and Martha served. But Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Would you imagine tonight a band? Can you imagine a small ensemble, okay? Maybe just a small ensemble. Josh, maybe just a small group in a church. If we could imagine that, Brother Brian, I would say that in this chapter, Martha is playing the drums. She's serving. You'll love the analogy here. Martha's playing the drums. And you know, old Mary, man, if I don't, y'all probably won't get sidetracked. I won't get sidetracked. But I tell you, you just can't wipe the oil, the ointment on his feet if you don't have no hair. That was free. I figured it'd go right over your head. But Mary's down at his feet worshiping, just like she's doing in Luke chapter number 10. Hey, look up here. Every time we find Mary, she's doing the same thing. She's sitting at his feet. Jason, she's sitting at his feet. And so if we're imagining a little ensemble here, Brother Landon, Martha is playing the drums, but here's Mary. She's playing the flute. That soft, sweet music. She's Brother Bennett, Miss Bennett, she's playing the flute. And then you've got Lazarus. Oh, Lord, you got Lazarus. He's sitting at the table. Well, what's he doing? Oh, my God. He just got raised from the dead. Hey, friend, he was dead. He was dead, and now, Brittany, he's alive. You know what I think, Mark? I think he probably couldn't get his eyes off Jesus. I think probably tears coming down his eye. And he's shaking his head. I can't believe I was dead, now I'm alive. I can't believe I was in a tomb and now I'm at a table. Amen. I said, I can't believe I was in a tomb and now I'm at the table. And so if we're talking about an ensemble here, Miss Bonnie, then if Martha's playing the drums, Mary's playing the flute, then I tell you, Miss Leanne, Lazarus is sounding the trumpet. What do you mean sound the trumpet? Because he's witnessing right there. Martha, she's the worker. Mary's the worshiper. And Nathan Lazarus is the witnesser. He's a living testimony, Miss Lynn, to the power of the resurrected Christ. Amen. He's the living witness to the power of a resurrection. Amen. And Brother Chris, that's what happened to Lazarus. And so you have Martha on the drums, Mary on the flute, and Lazarus playing the trumpet. But you know there's a fourth person in that text right there. There's a fourth person. And who's that? His name's Judas. Watch this. You'll love this. You'll love this. Judas, he's not playing the drums. And I promise you, he's not playing the flute. And he definitely don't have a trumpet. Judas doesn't even have an instrument. Because, Miss Jenny, he's selfish. Oh, God. He's got that critical spirit. When he saw that ointment, he said, why was not this ointment sold and given to the poor? Acting like he's all spiritual. Todd, acting like he's all holy. Saying that money shouldn't have been wasted at Jesus' feet. This should have been sold and given to the poor. And the Bible even tells us why. Miss Nathan's wife, Miss Ashley, the Bible even tells us why. He said, not because he cared for the poor, but because he carried the treasure. Yeah. Trey, God bless you, he was a treasure and he had the bag. It's terrible, isn't it? You better watch having a critical spirit. I said, you and I both better watch having a critical spirit. Because if you come around God's people when some peoples are worshiping and some are working and some are witnessing and all you've got is a critical spirit, guess what? You can't even join in the band. Yeah, it's preaching time, amen. You can't even get on the ensemble because you don't even have an instrument. And by the way, the Bible also said this is the same one that betrayed him. And this is the same man who went out and hung himself. And this is the same man, Jason, that sold the Lord for 30 pieces of silver. Ain't that something? Here he is, Brother Brian, here he is griping and bellyaching about the ointment and said, we could have got this amount of money for that, for the poor. And then here he is turning around, Caden, and he's selling out the Lord for 30 pieces of silver. And you know what it was all about? It was all about money for him. That's a bad way to be. But you know, in our little ensemble, Brother Douglas, Miss Douglas, I don't suppose we have to have the drums, but they make a good accompaniment. And really, Josh, I don't think we have to have the flute, but it sure is pretty. And Leanne, I don't reckon we have to have the trumpet. But I tell you, when you put the drums, you put the flute and you put the trumpet together, Brother Steve Abbott, somebody can make some good music. When you have a church, you've got some little worship and some little work, and Derek and Malia, some little witness. I'll tell you, that's pretty music in the eyes of God. Just make sure you're not the one without an instrument. Make sure you're not the one sitting around here with a critical spirit. Why'd he sing? Why'd she sing? Why'd he say that? Why'd they teach that? Why'd they look that way? Why'd they get called on to pray? Who told him he could lead singing? Who do they think they are? Listen, if you come to church around God's people and you've got the spirit of Judas, you just remember what I told you tonight. You're never going to get to join in on the symphony. You're not. You're always going to feel like you're on the outside looking in. You know why? Because that's what you will be. I want to say this, and that's not intended for nobody, and I'm not throwing it at nobody, but I am preaching. A critical spirit will get you nowhere. A critical spirit will get you. Listen, a critical spirit will bury you spiritually. Amen. Could I get another amen right there? A critical spirit will bury you spiritually. But here's what I want to say tonight. You remember in Luke 10, Miss Mercy, do y'all remember what Martha was doing? Brother Larry Newsom, in Luke 10, the Bible says she was cumbered about much serving. I went back even today, Miss Desiree, and I looked back over that, and it seemed like it almost appears, Brother Josh, that back at that night, I alluded to it, that there was more than just the Lord there. Some of the disciples could have go back and look at Luke 10. Some of the disciples could have very well been right there with him. And watch this. There they made him a supper. But if you look at even chapter 12, you could almost see that there could be, well, I'll tell you what, Judas, one of his disciples, was there. So it could very well have been so, Brother Joe, that the rest of the disciples were there. So in Luke 10, my point is, don't let me lose you, my point, Brother Miss Dean, is she was much serving. But in John 12, she's serving again. Now I want to ask you a question. All them people that came to that place when they heard that the Lord was there, do you think they were coming to see? Do you think they were coming to see Mary and the alabaster box and that ointment? They didn't know that was going to happen. Miss McGinnis, was they coming to see Mary? Oh, Brian, do you reckon, is there any thought at all that they might have been coming to see Martha? Doing the same thing she's always been doing? Mm-mm. Watch this. Here's what they were coming to see. Look at John 12. Look at verse number 9, John 12, 9. Much people of the Jews, therefore, knew that he was there. And they came not for Jesus' sake only. Here's my thought. But that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. Why? Look at verse 11. Because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Now here's my thought, and I'm going to let you go. Martha served in Luke 10 in spite of the actions of others. She just served. And the Lord said, you just serve in spite of the actions of others. Now this is where it really gets next to our human nature. Here, Martha is serving again. And I just want to envision, Brother Walford, that they're gathered around the house or looking in the window. They don't have windows like that. You know they don't. But they're looking in the windows. They're gathered around the doorway. And guess who they're looking for? They're looking for Jesus. And they're saying, there he is. There he is. Who? Lazarus. Don't you remember he was dead just in the last chapter? He was dead. There he is, sitting right there at the table. And they're thinking, Lord God, I want to get a glimpse of him. I want to get a glimpse of him. Watch me. And they people jostling and moving. So let me see. I want to get up. Look at the Bible. They came to see Lazarus. Nobody's coming to see Martha. Nobody's focusing on Martha. Nobody's looking at Martha. Nobody's asking about Martha. Nobody doesn't care what Martha's doing. And by the way, what's she doing? Same thing she's always doing, and that's serving. Now, here's what I want to say to this church, and I'm going to be finished. You should serve, and I should serve in spite of the attention that others may be getting, because we're not in it to get attention. Say amen. We're not in it. I love all of you, but I want to say this as a loving pastor. If you do what you do for the applause and the recognition of men, then that's going to burn at the judgment seat of Christ. And listen, if you have to be seen, I'll go a step further. If you have to be applauded, if you have to be recognized, that that's the motivation for you to serve, then you're contrary to what Martha is. Martha just served, Brother Nathan. She just served. Same thing as Luke 10. She just served no matter what the meal encompassed. The Bible said they made him a supper. Brother David said they made him a supper. So no matter what all that involves, she's still serving. And don't you know, Miss Blackwell, that she's serving? There's people at the doorways. People, look at the Bible. They're at the entrances. And there ain't nobody giving a diddly about what she's doing. The Bible said they come to see Lazarus. And by the way, look up here. I'd be in that crowd too. It's like Brother Yank, a fire truck. You get a fire truck in my neighborhood, I'm going to jump in my truck and go find out what the fire truck's going on. And that's how I am right here. Miss Jenny, Brother Stephen, if I knew somebody had been raised from the dead, I'd find out, Brother Hale, what house is he at? I'd like to see this person. I want to meet him. I want to see that. And by the way, the Bible said God used him to be a witness, and many of the Jews therefore went away and believed on the Lord because they saw that resurrection. All that attention, there's the word. All that focus, all the gaze of others, it really wasn't on Mary. And it definitely wasn't on Martha. They came there to see Lazarus. In this thing of serving the Lord, service for the master, service with a smile. Don't you love to go to a restaurant and the waitress greets you with a smile? Don't you love to be treated with courtesy? Somebody help me. Don't you love to be treated with respect? And by the way, what comes around goes around. If they're going to treat you that way, I say you should treat them that way. You should treat them that way. Treat them a bad way and then leave a gospel tract and a $3 tip, they're going to cuss you when you walk out the door. They're going to cuss you and say, bunch of hypocrite Christians. I ain't never going to that church where them people go. They don't even know how to talk to me right. Listen, don't be like that, because you'll be like Judas. You won't even have an instrument. The Bible said that not only for Jesus' sake, but that they might see Lazarus. They gathered around that house. No recognition, no honor. Nobody came to see Martha. But guess what Martha did? Biscuits, anyone? More taters? Can I get you something more? Can I get you something? And even her brother's a glory sucker. That's what he is. He's a hallelujah camp meeting huckster. He's just sitting there at the table. He's just sitting there. He's soaking in all the glory. He's loving it. He looks out the window. Yeah, I promise you. Hey, yeah, I was dead. I'm alive. That's me. I was in grave clothes, but I got my good clothes on now. Yeah, that's me. Well, don't mind her. She's just doing the same thing she's been doing for years. My sister never changes. She always serves. She always serves. Are you playing the drums tonight? Are you playing the flute? Are you sounding the trumpet? We need all three of them. And when it seems that nobody sees what you're doing, just remember, there's a God in heaven. He sees everything you're doing. I've laughed at my own preaching here lately. I've laughed, Brother Randy, because remember what I mentioned about the other week about an asterisk? Yeah. That some people, we do our service, but the Lord said, I'm going to put an asterisk by. I got to scratch that from the record. Because he murmured the whole time. He murmured the whole time. So God said, I'm going to put the asterisk by that, and that's going to be erased from the records. When it seems in your mind that everybody else is getting the attention, you just keep serving. Just keep serving. Because God, He keeps good records. Trey, He keeps good records. I just want to be faithful. I just want to be faithful. I want to be consistent. I want to do next year what I'm doing now. I want to serve. Martha, service with a smile. I think well, first of all, we ought to get the musicians up here. Come on. Let's do that first. Thank you. I know you're going to have a good song for us. I know you are. I just know it. I mean, I got that much confidence in you, young man. You're going to have a good song. I can't wait to see what song you got for. I cannot wait to see what song. And if you strike out, it's all on you. But guess what? We'll just keep serving. We'll keep serving. But I think when we give this invitation, you don't necessarily have to get out of your pew and come down here. But if you want to, you can. You really can. It's always open. But at least you ought to bow your head in your pew. And Miss Rand, we all ought to say, Lord, if everybody else is getting the attention, let me keep serving. And the earlier part of the message, if you're not saved, if you're not a Christian, you need to come down here. If you're a lady, we'll get some ladies to help you. If you're a man, we'll get some men to help you. Tonight is the night probably that you need to get saved. You need to quit worrying about it. You need to keep worrying about whether or not you're going to hell. Because I tell you, you don't want to go to hell. Let's bow our head. Heavenly Father, thank you for liberty to preach. Thank you for liberty to enjoy a good time of worship and preaching with God's people, this congregation tonight. Thank you for your goodness. I pray for that one that's here lost, that you'd save them. God, deliver them, their soul from hell tonight. I pray for all of us that we'd be like Martha. Lord, we just serve and just keep on serving and keep on serving because we love you. Bless the invitation now in Jesus' name. Amen. What we singing, Brother Cam? 4-4.